name is Furman Fordham. I am the senior pastor of Riverside here in Nashville. And we want to welcome you to our Riverside family and to our ministry. We are so happy that you have tuned in. Our prayer is that you will come to know God, grow in God, and sow God's love. We are praying that this presentation will be a blessing to you. And if you are ever in Nashville, we invite you to come worship with us. May God bless you, and we look forward to seeing you soon.
If the Lord has been touching your heart through this service so far, would you just say amen? God has just been moving this thing, and if you're like me, I really needed this today, so I'm grateful that God has been touching and massaging my heart today. We have come to a portion where we're going to receive the word of God, and we really do need that word. I want to ask you, if you will you turn in your Bibles with me to the book of Daniel? And we're going to look at Daniel chapter 1 and begin our reading at verse 6. It's Daniel chapter 1. Verse 6, when you have it, would you rest on your feet with me as we reverence the word of God? This is Daniel chapter 1 and verse 6. It reads, Daniel, Hananiah, Mishael, Azariah were four of the young men chosen, all from the tribe of Judah. The chief of staff renamed them with these Babylonian names. Daniel was called Belteshazzar. Hananiah was called Shadrach. Mishael was called Meshach. Azariah was called Abednego. But Daniel was determined. Somebody say determined. Daniel was determined not to defile himself by eating the food and wine given to them by the king. He asked the chief of staff for permission not to eat these unacceptable foods. Today, we want to speak from the subject, he's worth it. He's worth it. You may be seated. Oh, great is thy faithfulness. Oh, God, my Father, there is no shadow of turning with thee. Thou changest not, thy compassions, they fail not. As thou hast been, thou forever wilt be. Great is thy faithfulness. Great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I even when I don't deserve it, a new mercy. A new mercy, she said. Oh, oh, all I have needed. Hallelujah, God. Everything I've ever needed, your hand has provided it. Oh, God. Say, great is great. Come on, he's worthy of our praise. The great is our faithfulness. So many times before in your faithfulness, would you release your word, God? Give us a word in due season, and then make our hearts good ground. We pray that in the name of Jesus, and to the faithful God, we say, amen. Hallelujah, Jesus. We bless your name in this place, oh God. Can we just worship him for two more seconds? Say, thank you, Jesus. Oh God, we honor you. We honor you, God, in this place. We honor you, God, in this place. Every now and again, I find myself looking for a word for you. And God gives me a word for myself. I'm laboring in this word because it's hard for me. And so if there are some rough edges in this word, I want to ask you if you would just give me grace, because the cut is for me, not for you. Is that fair? The rebuke is for me, not for you. Word of God today is, he's worth it. Oh, thank you, Jesus. He's worth it. Here we are. I have learned over and over again, as I get closer to God, or as he comes closer to me, really, that his ways are not my ways. God's thoughts are not my thoughts. And oftentimes, I find myself emphasizing industry when God is emphasizing relationship. Find myself looking at what I'm doing, how much of it I'm doing, when God is emphasizing relationship. And so we as humans sometimes find ourselves emphasizing results when God is looking for faithfulness. We want to know how it's going to happen, how much the check will be for, that the foreclosure would be stopped, that the relationship will survive. When God's primary concern is faithfulness, in God's economy, it's not important where we go, but how we get there. Looking at the story of Daniel, I've read it time and time again, and I have been celebrating the results. I celebrate the fact that Daniel was given wisdom above everybody else, 10 times, in fact. I celebrate the fact that Daniel and his friends were given success and position. I have even found myself celebrating the diet that Daniel consumed along the way. But I have recognized that in God's economy, that none of that is God's concern. Y'all praying for me today? Daniel is in a situation that he has not caused himself. Someone else's unfaithfulness has caused him to be a slave. Someone else's unfaithfulness has caused his freedom to be limited. Have you ever been in a situation that you didn't bring on yourself, but someone else's, I was going to say a bad word, someone else's lack of wisdom has resulted in your pain. Someone else's lack of being judicious has caused you to be, am I in the right room today? Has somebody been in a situation that you did not cause yourself, but you got a bill that you didn't create? You got a relationship that's broken that's not your fault. And we find ourselves in these positions which cause us to make some decisions about whether or not we will continue to be faithful to God. Because why would I be faithful to God when he's allowing someone else's unfaithfulness to cause me pain? Why would I mean, didn't God see that coming? Could he not have protected me from? But here it is that I find myself in a situation because someone else has been unfaithful. When we read this, we recognize that the Babylonian culture is one that's cruel, very cruel. And so when Daniel and his friends are brought into Babylon, not only are they slaves of the king, there are some surgical procedures that they have to undergo to make them fit to serve. We have young ears in here, so I want you to follow me, adults. It is important to the king that there be no distractions for these men. And so in order to limit the distractions, somebody, without anesthesia, somebody, there are some surgical procedures that Daniel has been a part of. So watch this. He has been enslaved. His manhood has been limited, somebody. And when we find Daniel, we're expecting Daniel to be bitter. We're expecting Daniel to be questioning God. We're expecting Daniel to feel that he has already made enough concessions and that God should not ask him for anything else. Have you ever been there, somebody? I've already suffered. I've already given up. I've already lost out. I need a free pass right now. So this young man who has undergone all of this pain and loss is escorted to a dinner table. What I did not say is they also changed his name. They're calling him out his name. Changed his manhood. Took his freedom. He comes to a dinner table. And after all that has been done, the Bible says, but. Yeah, we're expecting an and. And Daniel did not care because he was hungry. The Bible says, but Daniel purposed in his heart that he would not defile himself with the king's food. Displaced from home, surgically altered, name changed, but financial hardship, relationship in the mess, but relocated, disconnected, but Daniel purposed in his heart that he would not defile himself with the king's food. Somehow, even in the storm, Daniel has purposed in his heart that he would not cause himself to be dirtied by the king's food. But it's just a meal. Oftentimes I've heard people talk about what was on the table, that, you know, there was wine on the table and that there were unclean foods. So you see a big old, you know, a plump hog with an apple in his mouth and lobster and crabs. But I am suspicious because there had to be like some grapes on the table. There was some healthy options on the table. There were some options that were clean on the table. But for Daniel, it wasn't even important what was on the table, but how it got there. Daniel was willing to forego even good options when they constituted a separation from God's will. Daniel was willing to forego something that people would understand when it meant that he would be dishonoring God. And my question for Daniel today is, how did you come about with a resolve that even though you were going through hardship, even though those things, your family and your friends that were stripped from you are still very heavy in your memory, even when it was not happening the way you wanted it to happen, how did you still resolve that you were going to be faithful to God? I'm not lying. If there was some grace on the table, I might have snuck one. I might have decided that I was going to move forward and say, you know, I've already given up enough. But Daniel purposed in his heart that he would not defile himself. I want to suggest a couple of things. I realize that Daniel has purposed in his heart not to defile himself, understanding that what was on the table would change him. You know, I read a statistic the other day that every 35 days that your body renews itself, and everything that you've been putting in your body for the past 35 days becomes your cells. somebody looking in the mirror like, oh, okay. So Daniel understood that a name change would not change him. He even understood that the surgical procedure, although it would affect him, it would not change him. But once he started putting things on the inside of him, once he started receiving things inside of him, it would change him. He said, you can change my name. That's fine. You can surgically alter me, but I am not going to consent to allow you to change my essence, to allow you to change my mind, to allow you to change who I really am. There are some options on your table today, somebody, that threaten to change the very essence of who you are, that threaten to change your cells, that threaten to change your makeup. And even though they are good, when they change you in a way that is opposed to God, that's not something that is appropriate for us. I'm trying. Like I said, it's for me. It's for me. Daniel says, I'm not going to defile myself. I'm not going to allow them to change me, because even though I'm going through this hardship, I am still God's property. It still matters what I allow to come into me. It still matters what I allow to influence me. And so while all of this is going on the outside, I'm going to preserve what God has on the inside. I'm going to remain faithful, even though this seems small. I'm going to remain faithful, even though people would understand. I'm going to remain faithful to God, even though I believe he'll give me a pass. I'm going to remain faithful, even though his love covers a multitude of sin. God is worth me passing up a meal. Is he worth it today? Watch this. The Bible says that he not only passes up that meal, he asks that the person who is over him would give him permission not to eat all of the decadent foods, but he places on himself a diet that is even more restrictive than the one that God has given. He says, give me vegetables and water. Scale me down. Take away all of the delicacies of Babylon. Don't even give me all of the sweets that are available off the king's table. Scale me down. I will even put more hardship on myself because he's worth it. I will make even more sacrifices because God is worth it. And watch this. In response to Daniel's faithfulness, God does just a few things for him, and we're going to get out of the way. When Daniel asked for this permission, the Bible says that God gave him favor with the people who were over him. See, there are some of us who are afraid to ask for things because we're afraid that we'll be told no. But we serve a God who is able to grant us favor with people who don't even know why they're giving us favor. The Bible says, this man said, I could lose my head for this. I could lose my job for this. But because God had moved on him, the Bible says that he gave Daniel favor at the risk of his own life. I want to tell you today that what you're afraid to ask for because you want to be faithful, God is wanting to grant because he is faithful. In response to Daniel's idea, in response to him saying, I will be faithful, God gave him favor where a man is willing to risk his life. He gave him favor, and then God gave him results. Somebody say results. We were looking for that. God gave him results. The Bible says that God made Daniel and his friends, number one, more handsome. Come on in here. Somebody say amen. He made them more handsome and strong than all of the people eating all of those proteins and all of the people eating carbohydrates. These men are existing on vegetables and water, and they look more healthy and more handsome than everybody else around. He made them more handsome. He also made them more wise and intelligent. But watch this. They're not just studying geometry and trigonometry. These people are wise men, and so along with studying math and science, they are studying astrology. They are studying the secret arts of Babylon. Come on in here, somebody. And God made them 10 times more wise in the secret arts of Babylon. He made them 10 times more wise in astrology than, wait. Isn't astrology against the will of God? Y'all come on in here. Shouldn't we move away from the secret arts? But watch this, because God knew that he could be faithful at the dinner table. God could trust him even in areas where Christian people ought not go. God made him 10 times wiser in the dark secret arts of Babylon because Daniel was faithful. There are some things that God wants to bless us with that are not traditionally Christian and not traditionally Adventist, but he can't send us because we ain't faithful. Because God knows that if we get in those areas, we're going to start to assume the ideologies that we're studying. But somehow Daniel is able to study things that are not like God, but also maintain a faithfulness to God. Am I reading the Bible? And I want to make sure I'm right, you know. Here it is that when the king is looking for someone to read the stars for him, he knows that 10 times out of 10, he's going to get a proper result from Daniel. Because he was faithful, God gave him results. And then God gave him success. Daniel reigned in the kingdom of Babylon and Persia. So even when the job got downsized, even when there was a change of hands, God still employed Daniel and elevated him to the top of leadership. All because he purposed in his heart that no matter what people were doing on the outside, he would not defile himself on the inside. He decided that no matter what anybody else around him was doing, he was going to remain faithful. Not for success, because there are no other stories like Daniel's anywhere else in Scripture. Watch this. Daniel can't look back to the first Daniel and say, I know that God will save me from this situation. Daniel can't look back in the past and say, I know that God will give me success. Daniel can't look back to the past and say that I know that I will have longevity. In Daniel's mind, it does not matter. He is preoccupied with being faithful to God, not for a new job, not for a new car, not for a new opportunity, not for a new boo. He is faithful to God because he feels that God is worth it. That because God is God, then he is worthy of trust. He is worthy of praise. He is worthy of adoration. And he is worthy of faithfulness. So what are you serving God for today? Are you here because you want to be healed? I need some healing. Yes. But if you don't get healed, is God still worth it? Are you here because you have a financial situation that you need Jesus to fix today? Matter of fact, yesterday. I need the check to be in the mail when I get home. Is that you today? And is God still worth your being faithful if the check is not in the mail? If the house is foreclosed, if the car is repossessed, is God still worth it? Is he worth it? Can I just talk to myself? Is he worth it if you don't get married? If you don't meet a boo? Is he still worth you being faithful today? Is he worth your being faithful if your dreams don't come true? If your family is not restored, is he worth it? Yeah, I'm looking, and I love going to Jesus because Jesus had something in his mind and heart. And I realized that Jesus comes to earth and he does his work of salvation without the assurance that we would receive eternal life. Without the assurance that we would receive him and receive his sacrifice. But the Bible says that God commends his love toward us in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died. Now, let's just put these two pictures together. We do great is thy faithfulness again, and then we'll go. I think we're going to get out on time, too. Watch this. Without the assurance that you would act right, Jesus said, you're worth it. Without knowing if you would preserve yourself as holy to him, Jesus said, you're worth it. Without knowing whether or not you would turn from your wicked ways, in fact, knowing in some cases that you would not, God said, you're worth it. So before the foundation of the world, he said, because they're worth it, I will step away from glory. I will step away from honor. I will step away from omnipotence. I will step away because I feel they're worth it. And he said, you're worth it, and you don't even act right. So wouldn't he be worth it when every morning he wakes you up? Isn't he worth it when every morning he puts new breath in your body? Isn't he worth it that even though you don't have a new car, he still helped you get a ride to church today? Isn't he worth it that even though your relationship is put together with duct tape, you still sit next to each other? Thank you, Jesus. Isn't he worth it that even though you don't have as much in your bank account as you would like, there's something in there. And even when there was nothing in there, he still gave you groceries. He still gave you gas. He still blessed you. Isn't he worth it today? Is somebody in here said, God, is he worth it today? Is he worth your praise? Is he worth your honor? Is he worth your trust? Come on, say, I trust you, Lord. Even if I don't get what I want, I believe. Great is thy faithfulness. He's worth it today. He is worth it today. I declare he is worth it today. And like Daniel, I know that there's somebody in here, you're faced with a decision. You're faced with a decision to preserve yourself. You're faced with a decision to preserve yourself, which would cause you to dishonor God. Your family will tell you, you better forget about that religious stuff and take care of your business. Even in your mind, you're looking and saying, God will understand. I need to feed my children. God will understand. I need this. I can't survive without it. But even if it means giving things up and making a sacrifice, is God worth it today? Is he worth you going into an uncomfortable situation without the assurance that everything's going to be okay? Is he worth it today? Is he worth you staying in an uncomfortable situation without knowing that everything's going to be okay? Is he worth it today? Is he worth you giving up a new job or a new house because the way that you would get in there is dishonoring to God? Is he worth it today? Is he worth you giving up a relationship because you have to dishonor him in order to keep the person you're with? Is he worth it today? Somebody has to make that decision, and I've been there. Let me raise my hand first. Say, God, I need your power to help me to remain faithful and to believe you're worth it. Is that you? Would you stand with me? God, I need you to help me to remain faithful and to believe you're worth it. You're worth the discomfort. You're worth the challenge. Even though I'm already hurting and I've already been abused, you're worth me staying faithful, God. You're worth it. Somebody else in here today has found that you are already dishonoring God. Already dishonoring God, and you need both God's forgiveness and his power to rescue you from that situation. You just raise your hand real quick. Just put it up, put it down. I need your power to rescue me from this situation. Lord, I've been dishonoring you. I've been compromising, and I don't want to compromise anymore. God, I need that power. I need that strength. And today, there's also somebody in here, and you have never made a decision for Jesus Christ. You want to give your life to him eternally and publicly, either through the profession of faith or through baptism. If that's you today, God, I want to serve you because you are faithful, and I want to show it publicly by being baptized. If that's you, you can come forward right now. God, I want to honor your faithfulness by giving you my life. Is that you today? That's you. When I ask you to come forward, we want to ask you to honor God's faithfulness today.
Thy faithfulness morning by morning.
So we do want to say thank you, God. We want to thank you that irrespective of our behavior, you always are faithful.
We're standing here right now as living, moving, breathing proof that the God of heaven fails not and his mercy is new every morning. God, we want to even say thank you because you've been faithful even though we were unfaithful. And when we have compromised and when we have done wrong, God, you have still found a way to bless us anyway. Thank you, Jesus. God, we honor you so much for that. But today, God, we want to move to the next level. We want to move to the next dimension. And we want to be faithful too. We want to honor you though the heavens fall. We want to honor you even when we're not receiving what we want. We want to honor you in the face of scorn. We want to honor you in the face of loss. We want to honor you in the face of pain, God. We want to be faithful no matter what. But, Lord, we need your power. God, we need your strength. We need your spirit because, Lord, the spirit is willing, but the flesh, Jesus, is so weak. So we're praying today that you would teach us faithfulness to do what's right because it's right. We're praying for those of us, God, who need release from situations we have entered because of unfaithfulness. And God, we beat back the ideas of the enemy that says that we are no longer able to reap your blessings because of our unfaithfulness. We know the devil is a liar. And so we're asking right now that you would begin to unhook the chains, God, that you would begin to destroy the yoke, that you would open up the doors, that you would open up the windows and release us from situations that we are in because we were unfaithful. And we claim new life right now in Jesus' name. We claim newness right now. We bless you in advance, God, because even if there's more pain, you're worth it. Even if we lose out, God, in this life, you're worth it. Even if we don't get our dreams and our visions and our ideas given to us right now, God, we say you're worth it. And we look forward to the day when all of the faithful throughout all of the ages will stand and say, lo, this is our God, our faithful God. We have waited for him, and he will save us. And so to that faithful God, we say right now, amen and amen. And we sing together, Lord, I'm